Tonight we're going to have a little singing, Ms. Nicole, Ms. Justin, Ms. Samantha. These ladies are going to sing stuff for you.
You might.
You pray for them, that's what I'm saying.
Thank you.
Tonight, I want you to take your Bible, turn to the book of Psalms, chapter number 139. The book of Psalms, chapter 139. If you would, leave your Bible open. We're going to look at several verses of Scripture. And there's a difference between teaching the Bible and preaching the Bible.
Yeah.
And when you teach the Bible, you can say something, but you better be able to back it up
right
with the book.
Yeah.
Then you take the book and prove what you just said. Preaching's a little bit different, especially to a group that knows the Bible. It don't take me long to learn whether or not a man is telling me the truth or not.
Yeah.
I don't have to listen to him long before I can catch on to whether what he's saying is right and true or it's not.
Right.
And so there is a difference between preaching the Bible and teaching the Bible. Part of the call and the qualifications of a pastor is that he be apt to teach. And so tonight we'll look at Psalm 139. And we'll read the first six verses. Look at it. O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my down sitting and mine uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off. Thou compassest my path and my lying down, and art acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. Thou hast beset me behind and before, and laid thine hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain unto it. Our Father, tonight we are grateful, thankful for another opportunity to stand and teach and preach the Bible. Lord, I pray you give the unprofitable servant clarity of mind and speech and on us and use us. Lord, I pray for the listener. May you grant understanding. And Lord, may you use the message tonight to help us understand more about who you are. Not just about what you do, but who you are. Lord, may we be made better by it. May we be drawn closer for it. And may we rest in the truths of thy word. Lord, when our flesh deceives us, when the world deceives us, I'm glad we can trust thy word. Lord, it is a rock among a desert of shifting sand. So I'm grateful for thy word. It trumps how I feel. It trumps what I think. It trumps my desires, my wishes, and my wants to. Lord, I'm glad for thy word. It's forever settled in heaven. And Lord, it is perfect without error. I'm thankful for something to stand on in these dark, confusing days. May you bless the teaching of it and the preaching of it. And may you have your will and your way tonight. And Lord, whatever you do for us, we'll be careful. We'll be awful careful, Lord, to give you all the praise and honor and glory. If you're the only one worthy, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Tonight, I want to deal with the subject of omniscience. You realize that God is omniscient.
Amen.
What that simply means is this. God knows everything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In the text I just read to you, David acknowledges this attribute of God Almighty. Look at verse 1. O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. God knows everything about you,
yeah,
and he knows everything about me.
Right.
Verse 2. Thou knowest my down sitting and mine uprising. That means God knows when you shut it down for the evening,
yeah,
and God knew when you got up this morning.
Yeah. Right.
Look at verse 2. Thou understandest my thought afar off. You realize God even knows what you think.
Yeah, yeah.
God understands the thoughts that run through your head.
Man, yeah.
And God is well aware of what you spend your time thinking about.
Right.
He knows our down, sitting, our uprising. He understands and knows our thoughts. Look at verse 3. Thou compassest my path and my lying down, and art acquainted with all my ways.
Yeah.
According to the three verses I've just read to you, God is acquainted with everything about you.
Right. Yeah.
He knows when you're happy. He knows when you're sad. He knows when you're right, as you know how to be with Him. And He also knows when you're backslid as a goat.
Yeah.
God understands and is acquainted with all of our ways. Verse 4. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. David said that the word was in his tongue. He hadn't even spoken that word yet, but God already knew the words he was going to speak.
Right. Yeah.
God knows everything. God never learns anything. God has never been astonished. God has never been caught off guard.
Yeah.
God has never been hit with some information. God never learns anything. You say, why? Because God already knows everything.
Right.
Literally everything. And so you'll find that this truth David proclaims in our text, that he knows our words even before we speak them. And look at verse number 5. Thou hast beset me behind and before, and laid thine hand upon me. When David begins to think about God's omniscience and how God knows everything, he says this in verse 6. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me.
Yeah.
He said, it's high. I cannot attain unto it. He said, I can't grasp this great truth that God knows everything. He said, man, it blows my mind.
Yeah. Yeah.
But hear me, even though God is invisible to us, we are not invisible to Him.
Yeah.
He knows all about us. And so when David considers this truth, he said, it's too wonderful to me.
Right.
Look at verse 12. Yea, the darkness hideth not from thee, but the night shineth as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to thee. Do you realize when most wickedness occurs? It occurs at night.
Yeah.
Right.
For some reason, people have the idea that nobody will see them if they commit their wickedness at night.
Right.
Now, that may be true, humanly speaking. But when it comes to the Lord, the darkness and the light are the same to Him.
Yeah.
And He is well aware of everything that everybody has done.
Right.
You'll find in Isaiah 49:1, this is what the Bible says. Listen a while unto me, and hearken, ye people, from far. The Lord hath called me from the womb, from the bowels of my mother hath He made mention of my name. Isaiah said, God called me from the womb.
Right.
He said, God knew what my name was going to be, even before my parents decided what they were going to name me.
Amen.
And he said, God already had a plan and a purpose, and God knew me before I was ever even born.
Right.
Take you back to Jeremiah chapter number 1. Jeremiah chapter number 1. I find this fascinating that the God we serve knows everything. And hear me, you and I are limited. And I was talking to my wife the other day, and I had thought about this verse in the book of Job. And Job said this. Job bellyaches and complains about how righteous he is. And then the Lord shows up in the last several chapters of the book of Job. And when the Lord shows up, you'll find he asked Job 85 particular questions. And Job could answer none of them. And so Job said, I won't say nothing. I'll lay my hand upon my mouth. And he makes this statement. He said, I am as a beast before you, talking to the Lord. Job said, I'm like a beast standing before you.
Right.
And the illustration is this. If you have a dog or have had a dog, it would be like you trying to explain algebra to your dog. Your dog is not wise enough. Your dog is not smart enough. He does not possess the ability to understand everything that you tell him.
Right.
The same is true with us and the Lord. That's a perfect picture of our relationship to the Lord. There are times we get frustrated. There are times we get discouraged. There are times we even get mad because the Lord didn't do something we thought he should do, or he did not do it at the time we thought he should do it.
Right.
And we become frustrated or discouraged with the Lord. But the truth of the matter is this. God knows way more about it than you do.
Right.
He knows way more about it than I do. God knows what is best, and God is going to do what's best, even if it causes you to be discouraged or causes you to be frustrated with him. He is willing to let you be frustrated with him till at some point down the road you figure out that, oh, my soul, that's why the Lord did what he did.
Right.
And so ever since I read that, it's been several months, I think this, that I am like a beast before the Lord. I am not wise enough or smart enough. I cannot see what's coming in the future. I cannot see God's plan, purpose, or reason for doing something. But if you'll just trust him and believe him, that he knows way more about it than you do, somewhere down the road, it will all make sense.
Right.
Now, look at Jeremiah chapter number 1. Look at verse number 5. This is what the Lord says of Jeremiah. Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. God told Jeremiah, I knew all about you before you were ever formed in your mother's belly. This is one of the greatest verses that condemns abortion.
Right.
That God knew Jeremiah before he ever formed him in the belly. And he already had a plan for his life, already knew what he was going to do with him, and God had a plan for him. Now hear me, abortion robs the individual of fulfilling the will of God for their life.
Right.
And so when you, here's the thing. They say, well, it's not a baby until it's born. According to Jeremiah 1:5, it was a person. God said, I knew you.
Right.
He didn't say a clump of cells. He didn't say, you know, that it really wasn't a baby. God said, before I ever formed you in the belly, I knew who you were.
Right.
God is omniscient. He knew all about us before we were ever born. And you'll find that God is omniscient. He knows everything possible and everything actual. All events and all creatures, the past, the present, and the future. He is perfectly acquainted with every detail in the life of every being in heaven, in earth, and in hell. I'm going to say that one more time. He is perfectly acquainted with every detail in the life of every being in heaven, in earth, and in hell.
Amen.
God knows everything about you.
Right.
Psalm 147 verse 5 says this, great is our Lord and of great power. His understanding is infinite. You ever catch yourself praying and you are explaining your situation to God? And you're saying somebody said this, or somebody did this, or this happened, and now I need this. And you realize God already knows all about it.
Right.
You already realize that God has a more perfect understanding than even you do. And I think if we grasp this truth, it would cut some of them real long prayers we pray way down.
Yeah.
That God already knew before you knew that you were going to have a problem. And God already had a solution before you ever even realized you were in need of a solution. And so tonight, God is all-knowing. You ever heard one of them deacons stand up and pray for 25 minutes, and he's explaining to God and educating God on, listen, God is omniscient. God already knows all about you.
Right.
Many years ago, there was a preacher friend, and he was he used to be a missionary. And while he was on the mission field, he had a great need. And so he said, what I'm going to do, I pray, and I'm going to write a letter and mail it back home. This was before the days of email and all that sort of stuff, back when you had to put pen to paper and put a stamp on it and drop it in the mail. And so he writes his letter and explains his need to his mission board. And he tells them exactly what's going on, exactly what he needs, and he takes that into the village. And in those days, it took several weeks for the letter to reach the United States and actually get to the person it was written to. And so he mails the letter, and he knew it would be several weeks. And as he's praying, within just a few days, he gets a package in the mail. And he opens the package, and it was the exact need he had been praying for.
Amen.
see, before he ever sent the letter, God had already burdened somebody's heart, and somebody had already mailed the answer before he ever even wrote the letter.
Right.
You know what that tells me? That God knows what you need, and God had already burdened somebody's heart to send him something to meet his need, and he was able to receive what he needed from the Lord long before he ever told anybody else about it.
Right.
And my point tonight is this: relax. God knows all about it. Relax. God knows what you're feeling. When you feel betrayed, when you feel hurt, when you feel wounded, when you feel discouraged, God already knows all about it.
Right.
And nothing escapes his notice. Nothing can be hidden from him. You realize that God knows the future. In Isaiah 46:10, this is what the Bible says, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. God already knows the beginning from the end. God already knows how that thing's going to turn out.
Amen.
God already knows how to get you where he wants you.
Right.
God already knows what's going to be best for you. And God has already got all of that stuff sorted out. You are not informing God of a problem. He already knows you got a problem. Now, here's what you need to do. You need to pray over the problem, but it's not necessary to explain all the ins and outs and the ups and downs and the details of your problem.
Right.
Because he already knows everything.
Yeah.
Bible says this in Isaiah 65:24, and it shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer. And while they're yet speaking, I will hear. God said before they ever ask, I'm already going to answer them. The only way God could do that would to be omniscient and know everything.
Right.
Take your Bible, if you would, to Matthew chapter number 6. Lest you think this is just an Old Testament phenomenon, it is not. It is biblical. From generation to revolution, you will find this truth that God is omniscient. Only one or two of y'all caught that.
I got
you. And so from Genesis to Revelation, God is omniscient. Now hear me, this should bring a great deal of relief to the child of God, that when I am shocked and when I am when life throws a haymaker at me, God is not surprised nor is he shocked about
right.
it.
Yeah.
And so that should bring a great deal of relief to the child of God. Matthew chapter number 6, look at verse number 1. The Bible says this: take heed that you do not your alms before men to be seen of them. Otherwise, ye have no reward of your Father which is in heaven. Therefore, when thou doest thine alms, do not sound a trumpet before thee, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have glory of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But when thou doest alms, let not thy left hand know what thy right hand doeth, that thine alms may be in secret. Thy Father which seeth in secret, seeth in secret, himself shall reward thee openly. When thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love praying standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. But verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which seeth in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. When ye pray, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think they shall be heard for their much speaking. Be not ye therefore like unto them. Here it is. For your Father knoweth what things ye have need of before ye ask him. You see that? God already knows what you need before you ask him. Look at verse 31. Therefore take no thought. I'm sorry. Verse 30. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Verse 31. Therefore take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. Do you see that? God already knows.
Right.
God already understands. God already is aware. And prayer is not informing God. Prayer is enlisting the help of God with the issues that we face. Flip over to Matthew chapter number 10. Just a few pages over. Matthew chapter number 10. And let me throw these two verses at you. Matthew 10 and verse number 29. Matthew 10 and verse number 29. This is what the Bible says. Are not two sparrows, verse 10, Matthew 10, 29. Are not two sparrows sold for a farthing? And one of them shall not fall on the ground without your Father. Look at verse 30. But the very hairs of your head are all numbered. What kind of God could walk through here tonight and speak to each individual and tell them how many hairs are on your head tonight? If the God of heaven can do that, not just for us, but for everybody on the planet, I dare say he knows all about everything. He can literally count the hairs on the heads of every living, breathing human being tonight. Now, he has had to do quite a bit of subtraction in my case, but he knows the hair on your head. That should give you a great deal of peace when considering God is omniscient. Hebrews 4:13. Matter of fact, flip over there. You need to mark this verse, and it'll help you. Hebrews 4:13. Tonight, we've been dealing with just the attributes of God, and we have dealt with God's omnipotence, his power. He has all power. And now we dealt with God's immutability and how God never changes. And now we're simply dealing with God is omniscient, and that means he knows everything. Hebrews 4, verse number 13. Notice this, neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight. Let me stop right here. He did not say people. He said creature. That means dogs, cats, aardvarks, lizards. That means everything. Do you see that? Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight. But all things are naked and opened unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. So God, listen, nothing's hid from God.
Right.
You can dress it up in a suit and tie. You can dress it up in a nice dress. You can paint it up with makeup. You can put a bow in your hair. But on the inside, God knows everything about you.
Right.
Yeah. Now, tonight, I am reminded of this great truth throughout the Bible. I'll give you one more. I'll read this one to you. Ezekiel 11:5, if you're taking notes. And the Spirit of the Lord fell upon me and said unto me, speak, thus saith the Lord. Thus have ye said, O house of Israel, for I know the things that come into your mind, every one of them. That's what makes it difficult trying to get over on God. You cannot. It is an impossibility for you to try to manipulate God, or to try to twist God's arm, or to try to present things to him in a way that is favorable for you.
Right.
Simply because he already knows all about it, and he knows the truth. You will never be able to manipulate him or try to paint yourself in a light that makes you worthy of a blessing when God already really knows the truth.
Right.
Now, I'm reminded that when this truth is found in the Bible. When no one saw Cain kill Abel, God saw it.
Right.
My God, there wasn't but a handful of folk on the whole planet.
Yeah.
And nobody saw Cain kill Abel, but God saw it.
Right.
And you will find that God punishes Cain because he knew what happened. Matter of fact, the Lord has an unusual way of dealing with people. For example, when Cain slew Abel, I personally believe he busted him in the head with a rock. You believe whatever you want to. But the Bible doesn't say he hit him in the head with a rock. We always assume that. Who knows? It might have been a fence post. I don't know. But I know this. Cain killed Abel. And then the Lord shows up and begins to deal with Cain. And he said, where is thy brother? Now God knew good and well where he was.
Right.
God knew he was dead. But yet he asked Cain, Where's thy brother? Cain's famous response is this: am I my brother's keeper? And you know what? God was giving him an opportunity to complain.
Right.
God was giving him an opportunity to be honest. And he already knew. Now, I'm reminded of Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve mess up. They ate of the fruit of the tree and realized they were naked. I heard one preacher say this: if Adam and Eve ate an apple off a tree and figured out they were naked, we need to pass a bushel around in this place. But they realized they were naked. They run and hide from God. You know what God does? God comes walking in the garden in the cool of the day and says this: Adam, where art thou?
Yeah.
It ain't that God didn't know where he was. Of course, God already knew what happened, but he wanted Adam to come to him
right. And
come clean. And Adam wouldn't do it. Adam hid. And so you'll find that even when God knows the answer, he will ask the question
right. Anyway. Right.
And so you will find when Cain slew Abel, God knew all about it. Let me give you another good one. You remember when Sarah is in the tent door and the Lord and the angels show up. They're on their way to Sodom to wipe it out. And they stop by Abraham's place. And Sarah's in the tent. And the Lord says this to Abraham: that Sarah, thy wife, is going to give birth to a son.
Right.
And the Bible says this: and she laughed.
Yep.
Who heard her laugh?
Yeah.
Nobody. She's in the tent by herself. Then how did the Lord know? Because he knows everything.
Right.
Then she tried to back up, and she was nervous and scared and said, I didn't laugh. And the Lord said, yeah, you did. You ain't going to get over on the Lord.
Right.
You're not going to do it. And so the Lord knew she laughed even when nobody else did.
Amen.
Now, I can tell you story after story. May I remind you, when Samson gets to the end of his life, he is getting ready to push those pillars down. And this is what he does. He says, Lord, give me strength one more time. Who heard him say that? Nobody. You believe what you want to, but I don't believe Samson was yelling at the top of his lungs
right. When
he asked God for strength one more time. And by the way, that crowd is having a big party. They're in a big coliseum. There's at least 3,000 people on the roof in the overflow. That means the bottom thing was full too. They're laughing, they're mocking, they're making fun of Samson, and they're making sport of him, the Bible says. But yet when the Bible says Samson bowed his head, he prayed and said, Lord, give me strength one more time. Who was there to record it? Everybody who was there died.
Right.
You say, well, somebody overheard it. Well, according to the Bible, everybody who was present died.
Amen.
Even if they did hear it, they didn't have a chance to go run out and write it down.
Right.
So how do we know that's what Samson said? Because the Lord was there. Amen. The Lord heard him say it, and the Lord put it in his book.
Amen.
Now, think about this. Jesus said this: when I come, he said, one will be in the field, two will be in the field, one will be taken, one will be left. Two will be asleep. One will be taken, one will be left. People didn't understand that for years. Until they figured out that on one side of the planet it's dark, while on the other side of the planet it is light.
Right.
Jesus knew it before we ever figured it out. See, your Bible is so far ahead of science, they're 150, 200 years behind what the Bible has to say. Jesus proclaims this truth because people thought, why? And back in those days, there wasn't no third shift. Everybody worked day shift. Everybody. They got up early in the morning, they worked all day till sundown, then everybody went to bed, and everybody got up the next morning and did the same thing.
Right.
In those days, there was no working at night. And so the question is, why would Jesus make such a statement? Why would he say two will be in the field working, and these over here will be in the bed? Either these folks are out of the will of God because they're up all night, or these folks are out of the will of God because they slept all day.
Yeah. Right.
And it didn't make any sense to them. But you and I have no problem believing what Jesus said. Why? Because we know that one side of the earth is dark while the other side is light.
Right.
You know why? Because God is omniscient. He knows everything. And so when you begin to study your Bible, you will find that the Lord proves his omniscience over and over and over. May I remind you, this is what the Bible says in Psalm chapter number 90, verse number 8. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. That's a scary thought. That stuff nobody else knows about? No. That's scary. But tonight, when you continue to think about the Lord and Him being omniscient and knowing everything, I can think of just a ton of verses that deal with this same topic. Take your Bible to Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9. We'll look at a couple of more. Matthew chapter number 9. You will find the Lord does this twice in the book of Matthew, once in chapter 9, once in verse 12, or chapter 12. Matthew chapter number 9, verse 1. And he, talking about the Lord Jesus, entered into a ship and passed over and came into his own city. And behold, they brought to him a man sick of the palsy lying on a bed. And Jesus, seeing their faith, said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, be of good cheer, thy sins be forgiven thee. Verse 3. And behold, certain of the scribes said within themselves, notice this, they didn't say it out loud.
Right.
They said within themselves, it was just a thought in their head, said within themselves, this man blasphemeth. Look at verse 4. And Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, wherefore think ye evil in your hearts? You trying to tell me Jesus don't know all about it?
Right.
Well, of course he does, according to the Bible. Now flip over a couple of pages of Matthew 12, let me show it to you again. And you'll find that the Lord knows our thoughts. And he rebukes those Pharisees, and they never said a word out loud. Before they could ever get it out of their mouth, the Lord rebukes them and says, why are you thinking evil in your heart? Matthew 12. Look at verse 24. But when the Pharisees heard it, they said, this fellow doth not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub, the prince of the devils. And Jesus knew their thoughts and said unto them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. Did you see that? Jesus knew their thoughts.
Right.
One of the greatest pictures of God's omniscience is found in John chapter number 4. Flip over there, I'm going to show you this, and then I'm going to read one or two more to you, and I want you to grasp this great truth, that God knows everything. Now hear me. God just doesn't know about today. God knows about all your yesterdays and all your tomorrow.
Right. Yeah.
God knows the past, he knows the present, and he knows the future. God is already aware of what you're going to face 6 months from now. God is already aware of what you're going to face 5 years from now. And God may be doing a work in your heart now to prepare you for what's coming a year, 18 months, 2 years, 5 years down the road. That's how good of a God he is.
Amen.
Did you ever think of this? That when you got frustrated because you couldn't find your car keys or your vehicle wouldn't start, that God already knew there was going to be problems on the road?
Yeah.
And God in his omniscience saw you getting in a wreck. And so the Lord wouldn't let you find your keys for 5 or 10 minutes until that problem, that dangerous thing had already passed
yeah.
by. And then the Lord allowed you to get back in your car or get in your car and go on down the road.
Yeah.
Did you ever wonder when you got hung up in traffic if it was not the Lord holding you up, preventing you from being in an accident 4, 5, 6 miles down the road?
Right.
The Lord does that sort of thing. But instead of being grateful and thankful, we stomp all over the house and flip out and freak out and lose our minds.
Damn.
Not y'all. I'm talking about me. Not y'all. I'm just talking about me. Look at John chapter number 4. Look at verse number 3. Talking about Jesus. He left Judah and departed again into Galilee. Notice verse 4. And he must needs go through Samaria. Jesus said, I have to go through Samaria.
Right.
Why? Because he stops at that well in Samaria. And guess who shows up? The woman at the well. Look down at verse number, look at verse number 6. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well. And it was about the sixth hour. Then cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, Give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away into the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, How is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritan. Jesus answered and said unto her, If thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, Give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. The woman saith unto him, Sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob? Boy, oh boy, was he. Which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself, and his children, and his cattle. Jesus answered and said unto her, Whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. The woman saith unto him, Sir, give me this water, that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. Here it is. Not only does the location. Jesus said, I need to go through Samaria. Why? Because he knew this little woman was going to be there. And he wanted to save her. So you know what the Lord does? The Lord said, I have to go through Samaria. So he goes over and sets on the well and waits on her because he knows she's got it. Amen. That's omniscience. Now let me show you something else. Look at verse number 17. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Oh, I'm sorry, verse 16. Jesus saith unto her, Go, call thy husband and come hither. Look at verse 17. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her, Thou hast well said, I have no husband, for thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband. In that sayest thou truly. She doesn't admit she's had five husbands. She doesn't admit that she's shacking up.
Right.
But guess what? Jesus already knew it.
Right. Amen.
She said, Won't you give me some of that water? And the Lord said, Okay, I will. Call your husband. Well, I ain't really got a husband. The Lord said, Yeah, you're right. You ain't. You've had five. And the one you're shacking up with is your husband right now.
Right.
Yeah.
The Lord already knew her condition before he ever said, I need to go to Samaria. In spite of what she was, in spite of where she was living, in spite of her sin, and in spite of her wickedness, in spite of her carnality, Jesus said, I got to go through Samaria. Why, Lord? Why do you have to go through Samaria? Because there's a woman over there that needs to be saved, and she's lost on her way to hell. Wicked, yes. Ungodly, yes. Shacked up, yes. Had five husbands, yes. But I'm going to go over there, and I'm going to be there before she ever gets there. And when she gets there, I'm going to have a conversation with her about water. But before I can ever give her of the living water that I offer, I got to deal with her about her sin. She has no idea that I know all about her sin. But I'm going to inform her. And so once he informs her of her sin, and he deals with that sin, then he gives her the living water, and then she can be saved. All because the Lord is omniscient and knew all about
her. Amen.
Yeah.
Revelation chapter number 1, I'm done. I'm going to give you this. God knows the future. Everything about the future. Everything. If you doubt that, Revelation chapter number 1. If you doubt that God knows the future, what do you do with Genesis chapter number 22? Psalm 22. Where he describes the crucifixion of Christ. And he says this in Psalm 22. They have pierced my hands and my feet. And he talks about how his heart is melted within him like wax. He is describing the crucifixion well over 700 years before Jesus ever shows up.
Right.
Read Genesis 22. I'm sorry, Psalm 22. Read Psalm 22. And you'll find where he talks about the bulls of Bashan having compassed me about. He talks about how they've gnashed on me. He talks about how they've pierced my hands and my feet. He is describing the crucifixion to the T. He doesn't give a general reference of a cross or the sacrifice. No, he gives details, how they pierced his hands and his feet. What do you do with Isaiah 53? 3, where he talks about he was led as a lamb before his shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. And you read Isaiah 52, 53, 54, right in there, and he describes the crucifixion again well over 700 years before Jesus ever shows up.
Right.
And so he gives you this prophecy and tells you this is what's going to happen. He explains to you that they'll pierce his hands and his feet, and we're talking somewhere between 700 and 1,000 years before Jesus ever darkens the door of humanity.
Right.
God already called it because he is omniscient. He already saw the thing happen.
Right.
He already knew how they were going to treat him. He already knew they were going to crucify him. He already knew he would hang on a cross. He already knew every bit of it, and then told you about it nearly 1,000 years before it happened.
Amen.
You say, why? Because God's omniscient. Look at Revelation chapter number 1. Verse 1. Look at Revelation 1 and verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him, notice the next statement, to shew unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. God said, this is what God said at the very first verse of Revelation. I'm going to show you things that are about to happen. God said, shortly come to pass. God's got a different idea of time than we do.
Right.
Because it's been over 2,000 years. But he says this, I'm going to show you some things in the following chapters of this book, and these things are things that are going to come to pass in the future. And when you study the book of the Revelation, you will find that it deals with the last 3.5 years of the tribulation period. You'll find that the church is raptured out, and then the first 3.5 years are relatively peaceful. The Antichrist shows up on the scene. Then he reveals himself, turns his back on that Jew, commits the abomination of desolation, and then the wrath of God falls on this planet. And so the book of Revelation covers the last 3.5 years of the tribulation period.
Right.
He goes to give you details and exactly what happens and exactly when it's going to happen and how it's going to happen. He talks about the sun being heated 7 times hotter. He talks about men will seek death and it'll flee from them. He talks about all these things. He talks about the mark, and he talks about all these things that are going to happen that are future as of right now today. These are in the future, but God just gave you every detail of the last 3.5 years of the tribulation period, and it ain't even come to pass yet.
Right.
It has been over 2,000 years since those words were written. 2,000 years before it ever comes to pass, or could possibly come to pass, and God said, this is what's going to happen. This is what's going to take place. This is how I'm going to deal with humanity. This is the Antichrist that's going to show up. This is his mark he's going to require you to take. This is all the things that are going to happen during the tribulation period. The thing is, God said that 2,000 years before. As of right now, it's been 2,000 years since he wrote those words.
Right.
Amen.
And you mark it down. Just as sure as I'm saved, it will happen exactly, precisely like God said it. You say, how can you have faith that it'll happen exactly like God said it would? May I remind you, he called Calvary 800-900 years before it ever happened, and it happened exactly like he said it would.
Right.
You know why I trust my Bible? Because God proclaims prophecy long before it ever happened. And God tells you what's going to happen, and then you watch that thing come to pass, you know he's telling the truth.
Right.
And so that's why I believe my Bible, is because God calls it, and then it happens. You realize there were over 300 prophecies concerning the first coming of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
The odds of getting them all right is to take a gold coin, one gold coin, and make a red X on it. Then throwing that in a batch of gold coins, taking those gold coins and covering the state of Texas this deep. Maybe even deeper than that, 3 to 4 feet deep. And you imagine this, the entire state of Texas covered in coins that deep. And then you walk in among all those coins and all that area, and you stick your hand down in there and manage to pull up the one that has the red X. You have better chances of finding the coin with the red X than you do all them prophecies being true.
Right.
Amen.
It is 1 to the 30th power. 1 to 30 to the 10th power. That's how many zeros are behind it. Those are the odds. And he called it spot on with Calvary. And if he called it spot on with Calvary, he'll catch it spot on with the tribulation period.
Amen.
Hear me. What separates Christianity from every other religion on the planet? Number one, our founder is not dead.
Amen.
Every other founder died. Yeah. And guess what? He's still in the ground.
Yeah.
Buddha, Confucius, every pope dies. Can I be honest? The guy, Charles Taz Russell, the guys who started, Judge Rutherford, the guys who started the Jehovah's Witness, Joseph Smith, who started the Mormons, guess what? All dead. Laid in the grave. That's true. They're all dead and gone. Jesus Christ is the only one who said he would die, but he would come back.
Right.
And then did it.
Amen.
He died and he rose again.
Amen.
And he's alive forevermore.
Amen.
That's what separates us. Number two, while I'm a Christian, is because of the prophecy concerning the things of God. God tells me before it ever happens what's going to happen, and then it comes to pass just exactly, down to the minutest detail, just like God said it would. God, in Psalm 22, he said, they will nail me through my hands and through my feet. Guess what they did? They nailed him through the hands and through the feet.
Right.
Now listen, every detail that he mentions in Psalm 22, 700, 800, 900 years later, it comes to pass exactly like God said it would almost 1,000 years prior.
Right.
Here's the other thing. Think about this. If it was just another religion, why would the disciples go to their grave believing? You realize to trust Christ as your Savior in the days of the disciples meant this. Your family would mark you off as dead. They would have a funeral for you and they would consider you dead. No fellowship, no birthday, no Thanksgiving, no nothing. They considered you dead. Society would reject you for trusting Christ as your Savior. You know what that means? No job, no work, no fellowship, no hanging out, no nothing. There was no financial gain in it.
Yeah.
Right.
So why would they stake their very lives on this thing? Why would they stick with Christianity? Why would they not deny him? Why would they follow him? Even when, listen, Christians were being thrown to lions and Nero would put pots in the ground down his driveway with a sharpened end, and they would take Christians and shove them down on that pipe through the chest, and that thing as big as a telephone pole would stick out of them. They would not die immediately. He would light them on fire every evening and light his driveway. Why in the name of Almighty God would they do that if it was just another religion,
right.
If it was just a social gathering, if it was just about ceremonies and rituals, why would they do that? You say, what would cause them to stand? Why do you think Peter was crucified upside down? Why do you think James was dragged through the streets and beaten with clubs? Why do you think every one of those disciples died a violent death? And the Apostle John was thrown in a pot of oil and he would not boil. It blinded him and scarring, and they banished him to the Isle of Patmos. Why in the name of God would they put up with that? Why would they stay with Jesus through all of that? This is why. He said he would die, and he did.
Yeah.
Amen.
But I saw him get up.
Right.
Amen.
They saw him come from the grave and arise from the grave. And that was enough to prove to them he was who he said he was, and he was God Almighty, and they were willing to spill their blood and give their lives for him because they knew it was not just another religion.
Right.
There was something different about him.
Amen. That's
Amen.
Right.
Tonight, there's something different about him.
Yes.
Amen.
Nobody else could make the prophecies that he made.
Yeah.
And he told you what's going to happen. Just as if, just like he told the sinner, if you don't trust Jesus as your Savior, you'll die and go to hell forever.
Yeah.
Amen.
God is not a man that he should lie.
Amen.
Tonight God is omniscient. He knows everything.
Yeah.
Nothing can be hidden from him. He knows it all.
Amen.
I'm glad that God knows where I am tonight and what my need is.
Amen.
I'm glad.
Yeah.
I'm glad he already had a plan before I had a problem.
Yeah.
That's a good God.
Amen.
Tonight, God is omniscient. That ought to encourage you.
Yeah.
You ain't got to say, well, Lord, let me tell you what they've done to me. He already knows.
Yeah.
Well, Lord, they said, he knows. Well, Lord, I ain't got the money. My power bills are on. I ain't got the money. He knows.
That's right. Amen.
He already knows where you are.
Amen.
And he knows how to take care of you.
Amen.
Bless his sweet name. Father, amen. I'm grateful tonight that you're omniscient. And Lord, if you were omniscient, but not omnipotent, your omniscience wouldn't mean a whole lot. Just that you knew. But Lord, because you're omnipotent, not only and omniscient, not only do you know, but you have the power to fix and to take care of whatever's coming my way. So Lord, I'm grateful that you know it all and you have all the power to take care of it. Thank you for who you are. Not just what you do, but thank you for who you are. Thank you that you know all about it. I'm grateful, Lord, that I've never brought a problem to you that caught you off guard. And Father, tonight, may your people find peace and comfort in this truth that you are omniscient. Bless your name. We certainly love you in Jesus' name. Amen.